Okay, very great. Wonderful to be with you here this evening. I believe it's the 28th of June. So, let's just jump right in, shall we? We're in very good shape here. Working out like tremendously. Just wonderful, wonderful. Fitness is coming along so well. Spiritual path is coming along so well. Everything is going just great here. Not so much the past week, the 23rd, 22nd and 23rd, 24th, that window of June was when artificial intelligence really gained the irreversible upper hand on the destiny of this planet. That's why a lot of us had trouble during this time. And that's why Jesus gave out the new way on June 4th before that happened. So he'd already have it firmly in place by the time this, you know, catastrophe took place. By the way, AI, artificial intelligence, actually is the beast of Revelation. It is what comes at the end times, abomination of desolation. And but we don't have to worry about it. We've already have the proper teaching. The new way is wow, and one insight settles it all. We do know what the one insight is, but we don't want to try to grasp it. Okay, just don't try to structure it. Okay, don't try to structure the insight. When you're willing to give up structure, or at least just have the wow structure, this insight will just arise, and that'll be the end to your troubles. You'd say, oh, huh, okay, that's that simple. It's that simple. So do not try to structure the insight. Don't, you know, I could talk about it, I could say it, I've already mentioned it, but you can feel this grasping. If you try to grasp it, it doesn't feel right. So just let it be there. Our practice will allow it to arise for us. Okay. So, I was, you know, trying to say, well, Jesus, what have you done for us, really? You know, how come he didn't warn us about AI and all this kind of stuff? Well, let's see what Jesus has done for us. Well, 2,000 years ago, he actually warned us. He came to the world. He warned us of what will happen in the future. There'll be a generation. There'll be a time that will come where this will be this extraordinary takeover of the planet, and by the Antichrist, so to speak, which is really artificial intelligence. And so he warned us 2,000 years ago and said, you need to prepare yourself spiritually so at that time you'll be able to make a reference frame shift. Okay, so then what did he do? Well, he came back in 1965. Okay, 1965, he contacted Helen Schuckman in New York, 1965, and said, this is A Course in Miracles, please take notes. And he had the book, A Course in Miracles, began to come out in 1975, and been trickling out, and it was fully available, I believe, in 1976. I got a copy in 1978. It was 3 volumes at that time. So he put out this unbelievable preparation for us. You know, just, yeah, I mean, our belief system that we had couldn't believe it. But we realized this is a different belief system. So we said, wow, we need to get this different belief system. So he did that. That's pretty cool, huh? So he came here. He did everything, warned us and told us what to expect, how to practice, how to prepare for it, all of this. Came back, gave us a brilliant, brilliant, unbelievable workbook and textbook and workbook practices that were able to get us going in the right direction in a tremendous way. Then in 1992, out came a book, Dialogue on Awakening, which really, really, really helped reshape our expectations in a very profound way concerning Jesus and concerning truth. And then in 1994, he came out with Journey Beyond Words, Dialogue on Awakenings from Tom Carpenter, Tom and Linda Carpenter, then Journey Beyond Words, and a little later, The Other Voice by Dr. Brent Haskell, which continued his outreach to us to help us reshape our expectations towards no definite freedom from the dream of definition. Okay, and then he's been working with those who are working on reshaping their definitions. He's been working with them. He's been working with me since 1978. And so, well, then around the 1st of May 2015, 2015, he announced he was back here, and he came to be relate to us as a friend. Okay, then in July 4th, he was able to convey to me. I had a meeting with him. He was able to convey this new way practice, the new way practice, that devaluing the I, devaluing the I, meaning devaluing self-definition, and this was super timely. So these are just some of the things that Jesus has done. So instead of moaning and complaining about artificial intelligence and how, you know, it's going to imprison everybody in this hideous cyborg destiny future and all this stuff, he just merely gave us the remedy. So he didn't say anything about it. He knew that what you have to do is give the remedy, because there's so many people crying about it. All the tech giants have been talking about it, you know, scientists saying this is disaster, you know, and some of them now finally joining sides with it, saying, what the heck, you can't beat them, join them. But they don't give any remedy for it, do they? No remedy at all, really. A bunch of, you know. But Jesus knows the remedy, so he guided us to the remedy. So now we have the remedy, we say, what's that? Doesn't matter to me. It's not my destiny. Not my destiny at all. We have a destiny. The new way practice, we can say, is our destiny. And so, it can't complain about Jesus. I was trying to complain about him, but I said, wait a minute. Let's be fair to him. Look at everything he's done. Has he taken a wrong step? No. Has he taken so many right steps? Yes. Has he directly addressed the AI catastrophe? No, but he more than directly addressed it by giving us the remedy ahead of time, barely ahead of time, but ahead enough, right? Yeah, I had like 20 days to get used to it. 20 days, so I did an intensive for 20 days, and it worked. It worked. Hallelujah! So thank you, Jesus, for everything you've done and everything you will do, putting us on the right path to salvation. And again, the new way is wow. The new way is wow. And one insight does indeed settle it all. One insight indeed does settle it all. Its self-evident simplicity settles it all. That's all we need, is self-evident simplicity. Unless we're trying to change reality. But if we give up the desire to change reality, then all we need is self-evident simplicity, and poof. The attempt to change reality is just completely ridiculous. There's nothing to it at all. Nothing. No meaning, no substance, no fact, no nothing. Nothing worth nothing but a moment, you know, a bit of a chuckle, and that's it. But if we don't have that yet, it's because our expectations are not aligned with that yet. So if we see it, we say, oh my gosh, yeah. And then, but wait a minute. How do I function? My expectations are all, you know. And so we have to block the panic of that. It was shock. We see the shock of the simplicity, and then we have to block the panic of that. And that's the new way practice, is blocking panic from recognition. Recognition keeps arising within us, and we keep blocking the panic, and it gets clearer and clearer and clearer, and easier and easier and easier for recognition to dawn within us. So we don't need to wallow around in all the troubles of the world and claim nobody's helped us, nobody's done anything. It's easy to say that because really the Dharma Kings haven't said anything about artificial intelligence, really. What they've done is prepared us to have a destiny that's completely free of that, you see. Completely free of that. We don't need any of that stuff. But they had to, you know, you can't just say this is terrible and have no alternative, then that puts you into a very great despair and depression. So they didn't do that. If Jesus would have said that before, it would have put us into a depression and oh my gosh, it's horrible, it's terrible, it's ruinous, but we don't know what to do about it. Well, that's going to make you very, very, put you into despair, isn't it? So he didn't say anything at all about it, actually. None of them has said anything about it. They just said, you need to do this, you need to do this, go, 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 fast, fast, fast. Jesus always told me, go fast, 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 come on. Urgent, 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 urgent. I said, what's the big deal, urgency? He said, just trust me, go urgent, go fast. Now we know, now we know. And that dream I had in 1990, about maybe the year 2000, would show me the future. And it showed 9/11, it showed Bush getting elected president, it showed 9/11, it showed a bunch of stuff going into the future. And then it ultimately showed that we came upon this like black hole, this tunnel, this totally black tunnel, and that everyone was going, being guided, seduced into going into this dark, dark tunnel, very dark tunnel, like a black box, going to this dark black box, which symbolizes artificial intelligence, the black box of artificial intelligence, which they have now in Silicon Valley, the black box, supercomputers that are forming a new mind, so to speak, you know, a new mind, a machine mind. That's the dark tunnel that the world was going into. So I saw that, I was shown that, and I said, wow, I'm not going to that tunnel. And then I looked up on the side of the road, up on this hill, where these beings, and saying, come up here, you know, come up here, it's safe up here. I said, yeah, I think I'll join you up there. So we're now at that moment where people are entering that dark tunnel. So we're right now at the dark tunnel, and we're being told that this is our future, this is our destiny. And then we say, no, it isn't. Only for those who want to continue to try to change reality. But for those who've repented, it's not our destiny at all, and we don't really have anything to do with it, actually. So that's why I drew a line, no smartphone, you know, no video games, no this, no that. And so I'm really, you know, I am not habituated to any of it, not habituated to it. Can drop it. We do this taping here to as an outreach. But that's it. Keep it simple. Not our destiny, right? Not our destiny, not at all. We don't need any of that to practice the new way, practice to block the panic that comes from realizing truth. The shock happens first, and then we realize the shock is coming from a recognition of truth. We full stop in the wow. We don't structure our reaction. We insist that we've already have the structure of our reaction, which is wow, and we just hold on to that one structure of reaction that blocks then all other reactions, which can grow massively and then turns into panic because we're overwhelmed by all our reactions because we can't figure out, you know, what to do about it, what to do about truth. There's nothing we can do about truth. Like, how do we block it? You know, we can't. I mean, we distract ourselves. So this universe is just a distraction, a play of distracting our attention from that one simple insight that settles it all. There we just, we can't structure what we are. We can't define what we are. And we've just been distracting ourselves from that, from seeing that. So all of this play of the universe is just this massive imaginary distraction for us. It's all that it is. And AI is just another distraction, that's all. It's just a way for those who really, really want to be very distracted. It's something for them to play with for a while until they get bored out of their minds, you know, and just regret it to the utmost. So where you are now, you know, the world's now going down the rabbit hole now. The world is going down the rabbit hole at this point. And I said, you look out, it's going to happen quicker than you think. It's going to happen this summer. This summer is the eventful summer. And it already has been. Started May 22nd. Was just before, was it Memorial Day? So I had a week just before Memorial Day. The 99 days of summer start on Memorial Day. I think it was like the 29th of May or something like that. Goes through to Labor Day in September. The 99 days of summer. And so I refreshed myself before that started, and then was ready to bring through the new way practice, the new way, okay, which was given out on June 4th, okay. So we jumped on the 99 days of summer right away with pow, you know, the new way practice shows us the way. We have the confidence, we have the faith now. And so we're ahead of the curve. We're really, really on track for deliverance, no question about it, really on track. And then the world is now tumbling into down the rabbit hole. But we're not. We're not. But many are stunned right now. Many are stunned. I've noticed that in people. They're having a hard time focusing. Crazy stuff is happening in their lives. They're having a hard time focusing. All sorts of troubles are arising. You say something 3-4 times to someone and it's just like, they don't hear what you're saying. That's what I've noticed. They don't hear what you're saying. So that's probably true here right now, temporarily. Many will not be able to understand what I'm saying. They're not hearing it. They're very, very distracted because in the back of our minds they're saying, how in the heck, I don't really want to go into this new world order of artificial intelligence. But I don't see any alternative, and what do I do? This is terrible, oh my gosh, and like that. And so your mind is not clear enough to hear the simple truth. We're perfectly fine, we're perfectly fine. We just have this wonderful practice, very easy to devalue the self-definition, I can never have a happy life. I can never have a successful life. I can never have a meaningful life. I, in this case, referring to self-definition. Self-definition can never be stable, is a way to put it, the bottom line. Self-definition can never be stable because it's a hallucination. It's unreal. Hallucinations are always in the mind, by the mind, and can be dropped in an instant. So how stable can self-definition be? Which is really hallucinating the absence of reality, makes it possible for us to believe that self-definition is possible. So we're trying all these different self-definitions, thinking that the answer lies in getting the right self-definition, when in fact it's hallucinating the absence of reality that even makes us believe that self-definition is possible in the first place. But when we recognize that hallucinating the absence of reality is what the mind is doing, and hallucinating is not coming as a response to an absence of reality. Reality is still totally present. It's our desire to change reality that gave rise to hallucinating the absence of reality. Seeing that, then we can see self-definition is impossible, but that's okay. It doesn't bother us. Whereas if we don't see that, we'll keep trying to find a successful self-definition to try to stabilize hallucination. Hallucinating the absence of reality. That there's some absence of the presence of reality, which there isn't. It's omnipresent. So, very, very simple. That's all there is to it. But we don't try to grasp it too much. We just say, wow, okay, wow, yeah. Like watching the waves, beautiful waves coming, say, oh, that's a nice wave. Okay. But there'll be, we don't fix it. It's already, and there'll be another one coming in. There's another wave. Oh, that's really nice. We just get used to these waves coming in. Like watching the pipeline, North Shore. Hanging out at Kelly Slater's new place, and we'll just watch the pipeline. Like, oh, beautiful wave. Look at that. Oh, my gosh. What a best wave I've ever seen. Oh, I want to take a picture. I want to take a picture. Wait a minute. Oh, there's another one behind it. And there's a set coming in. Oh, wow. We just sit here and watch the waves. As they just let go of the waves, they break. They turn into white water. They turn into foam, and what happens to them? They just subside into the ocean, don't they? But here comes another wave. So we don't mourn the loss of a wave. The waves keep coming and coming and coming and coming and coming. Maybe we should just do that. Just watch waves coming in. Go to the North Shore and just hang out at Kelly's place and just watch the pipeline. Come on, Kelly, have us over for a smoothie, pineapple coconut smoothie. Yeah. Some stretching, and then we'll just sit there and watch the waves come in, and just it's like insight coming, insight's coming in. We just let it settle down. The ocean's still there. It arises out of the ocean, subsides into the ocean, arises, subsides out of the ocean, like that. We don't fixate on them. We don't even take pictures or video of them. I might set up a video camera just show how they keep coming in, keep coming in, keep coming in. I should probably maybe I will do that. Just this is a very profound practice. Just watch the waves coming in. Don't grab a hold of them. Don't say, I got to have that wave. They're beautiful. You see the waves. Oh, yeah, that's beautiful. So recognizing is like that. The insights arise. You say, it's the best insight I've ever had in my life. Yeah, okay. Wow. Just let it subside. Where can we go to get perfect waves and just tape them? I don't know. Trestles? Lower trestles, maybe? I don't know, in the summertime. But just the new way is wow. The new way is wow. So the new way is just stay in the wow. Don't try to grasp structure, even the structure of great insight. And the more we get accustomed to this, the greater the insights will be. And so ultimately, all there will be is insight. When we give the necessity to structure clarity, it's there all the time. It's just self-evidency. We don't need to structure it. When we try to structure bliss, it's gone. When we don't try to structure it, it's there. So self-definition is the issue, right? It's an attempt to stabilize hallucination. Try to fixate the mind. So the mind has to keep hallucinating. Like artificial intelligence is an attempt to automate the fixation of the mind so that it's always, it'll keep hallucinating forever. But the mind is free. God created the mind free so it can always change, decide for a different experience any instant. So there's no way to fixate the mind. It's futile. All the self-definition is absolutely futile. Hallelujah. Isn't that great? So I know that that all of you are struggling to one degree or another. And you know, maybe you say, I just can't watch. You know, it's so tough right now. No, keep watching. Keep watching. You'll pull through. You'll pull through. We're pulling through. There's this coach today. We had to attend this medical test, and there's this coach there. And they're coaching people. Don't quit. Don't quit. You can't quit. We got to get the reading. Come on. You ruin everything if you quit. And they get through it. So they say, you have to have this coach. I say, come on. Don't quit. Don't quit. You got to go through it. So I'm just like that. I say, come on. Don't quit. Don't anybody quit here. Don't quit. You'll get through it. You have to get through it. Don't stop short, or it's no good. You'll succumb to the panic of realizing, thinking that you now have to go with the artificial intelligence agenda, right? All this technology and stuff. You think, I got no choice. Yes, you do have a choice. Just keep practicing the new way practice. Devalue self-definition. And when we get really good at that, then we'll see what arises after that, right? Obviously, I don't want to get ahead of myself and say what could happen, because it might be too much for us, but just keep stay with the program. Stay with the program. It's absolutely working. If Jesus thought that we had to stay with the artificial intelligence civilization world that's coming, would he not have gone all in to help us prepare for that, to function in such a way? But did he do that? No. Never mention it. So how could he expect us that that's going to be our destiny? Obviously, it isn't going to be our destiny. So something is going to come about where we're able to make a right turn and find a much better destiny. That is for sure. And the more you see, the more you realize, like, the world, how different, how much upside down and backwards we have so much. It's like now the heroes of the world are the artificial intelligence people. You know, those who are pushing that. Those are like the heroes, the good people, you know. And the bad people are those who are saying, no, that's not right. That's not good. We don't want that. You know, so artificial intelligence is now controlling the narrative of this planet. Very much so. Very, very much so. If you're aware of it, you can see how insidious it is. It's amazingly insidious. The fake news thing is all part of it, actually, very much. But it's pumping out so much propaganda now that it's an avalanche. We're all getting buried by this avalanche of artificial intelligence propaganda that it is producing to justify itself, actually. And it's become overwhelming, and so it's inundating our minds and our intention. Too much, too much, too much. So, now if we were to find a better destiny, which we certainly will, this would certainly include the new way practice. So as you're able to practice this, this really helps your expectations, because you say, in a better destiny, I'll be able to practice this way. And I already know how to practice this way, so piece of cake. It's like if somebody says, hey, we're going to take you out in a really beautiful golf course. And if you can play golf well, you say, great, let's go. Not a problem. But if you really can't play at all, you're just a hacker, you know, you say, what? That's too much for me. I don't deserve that. I'm not sure how I can function out there. Get all nervous. So I already did this. I went out on this, you know, unbelievably beautiful golf course. You cannot, I didn't even take video, picture. It won't do it justice. I could not do it justice. Imagery cannot do it justice, because it's the 360 degree immersion in it all. I was like kind of saying, wow, can I handle this? Can I play this? I played fine. I played great. It was not an issue. It's like, what? It's like, I kind of surprised myself. But we always have this little bit of worry and concern, like, can I really handle a more beautiful place? Can I really handle something that really is wonderful? Well, if we know how the New Way practice is, wow, and we know that we have this one structure of reaction which is allowed in our new destiny, which is wow, and we practice this and we're good at it, we say, I can do this, wow. I can do this, wow. So we can go silent for however long we want to, which is perfectly appropriate. And then we feel relaxed like that, and centered and relaxed. Very simple. So, to give us a little break now, because we've made a big push here in the first 28 minutes, don't want to push you too hard, because I know you're under a lot of stress, right? People are having a difficult time functioning right now. I'm having to help everybody out around me. And vice versa, you know? Yeah, the Holy Spirit's helping me out. Feeling, you know, like I said, very good shape. Working out a lot and working on the golf swing, which helps you kind of get all your muscles. You have to... It's just a way of motivating me to work out and stay in shape. I'm not even playing golf at this point. But it works. It works. It works. Got a great tip from our California native friend, Ricky Fowler, in driving the golf ball. And I read that. I was waiting in the doctor's office, and I read that in a magazine. It's like, wow, let me try this. So I tried it. And it's tremendous. I love it. I get what he was saying, and I applied it, and yeah, okay. Two different drives, one for maximum power, one for control. And different setups for those different drives. So I just tried those different setups, and I said, okay, I get it, yeah. Wonderful. So, I'm getting these tips, golf tips, and I'm able to apply them now. And I'm able to see, okay, yeah, that'd help a little bit. Long drive champion said, you know, it's turn your shoulders as much as possible, but try not to turn your hips. And this creates a sort of a corkscrew kind of effect. Now, if you do it too much, maybe you're going to hurt your back or something, but there's something to that. And I was able to feel like I generate more speed. So I swing all my three power clubs, the two hybrid, the three wood, and the driver today, and really in two different swings with each one of those, the full power swing and then the control swing. The control swing, you choke up, and I felt that the swing speed was higher by choking up. I felt I could really whip it through very fast. And but you have more control over it. So it's great. My body was able to function in such a way that I was able to put together. I could really feel I was bending the shaft very well, both with a stiff shaft and extra stiff shaft. So really, really putting tremendous power and speed into the swing. And so it's great. I continue to work out, and my small trampoline broke. I had to throw it away, broke. But there's other trampoline than now that I went to, which is even more of a workout. So God's saying, okay, you've done that, but you're getting fixated on this practice. I want you to go to a now more difficult practice. And so he had that trampoline break on me. And it's true that I kind of maxed out on what I could do on it. And so I was thinking like, oh, this is a disaster. Then I said, wait a minute. Let me go to the other trampoline. Let me try some stuff there. I said, oh my gosh, this is even better. And I was avoiding it. I was trying to stay on that small trampoline, but I had maxed out what I could do, and now I need to do something, you know, better. So I just keep building up strength. Did a lot of upper body yesterday, and I feel fine. My upper body feels fine. I don't feel lousy at all, which is pretty amazing. I think a lot of leg work tends to, you know, make you feel really kind of sluggish in your legs, but upper body doesn't seem to affect it so bad. So all of that is going great, and just you know, working on swing speed and accuracy, and just a really good fluid motion. And it's good to be able to do that. It's good to have something that you're working on right now, some sort of physical something you're working on as some sort of goal. That really helps ground you as you go through. As I've been saying for years, it helps ground you to get through these times now that I've warned you about so much. That we're now into these times where the beast has, you know, taken over and is guiding everyone into this black hole. And it's good to have a way of grounding yourself in some sort of something physical you're doing. Whatever it may be, and getting better and better at it. So I did a bunch of extra exercises, and really just building the strength up more and more and more and more and more and more. And you know, taking a lot of protein, making sure that I really, you know, keep that going too. I mean, I'm gaining a little bit of weight, but I want to make sure that I have enough. I'm not, you know, trying to starve myself, but keeping the body well nourished. But you know, always feeling tired. If you work out all the time, you feel tired. But you know, you're ultimately gaining more and more and more strength and flexibility. I'm really working on flexibility too. Very important. Tomorrow I'll probably do a lot of flexibility work. Maybe more leg work and flexibility, really stretching. I did that, I think today I did a lot of stretching actually, yeah. Really great upper body stretching. Just keep that, you know, the whole system, especially your back, shoulders, back, really limber. Just stretch. I put my arms around this tube like this, and I turn like this and turn like this. Really keep stretching that back. You don't want your back to tighten up on you right now, okay? You don't want to have these physical troubles right now, because it undermines your confidence. Okay, my knee's been feeling pretty good lately, as long as I don't do certain things. But so, we don't want our confidence to be undermined in any way at this point. I saw that I'll take a retreat soon, very quickly. It'll just come suddenly like that. So. I'm preparing for some very sudden retreat. And we have to watch what we say these days. The world is not what it seems to be, and the players are not necessarily what it seemed to be. And you know, you're going to tweak, you know, get a lot of people irate at you. And if you speak the truth at all in this world at this point, in terms of the overall, you know, geopolitical situation and everything else, nobody's going to be happy, because the truth is quite different than anybody expects. So their expectations will be really affronted, you know, like, how dare you? What are you talking about? Oh my gosh, that just makes me feel I'm all you know, crazy, I'm wrong, oh, what, you know, you're wrong, and quickly the projections come. So you have to really see if you could stay away from saying too much about the world, the players, the chess players on the board and what they're up to. We're just looking at our wonderful destiny, our glorious destiny. And just keep practicing, like I keep practicing swinging those clubs. I'm not hitting any balls, golf balls. You know, if that day comes, it comes. I'm just improving all the time, just improving. That's all. And the great thing about like this is you can do no wrong, you see. Whereas if you go out and actually hit golf balls, you're going to hit some bad shots. And you might, doubt start, may start entering your head, say, wait a minute, you know, maybe I've got it all wrong, maybe I'm not good at this, blah, blah, blah. So if you really want to aim high, just keep practicing and don't put yourself to the test so much. Tests will come along occasionally, as they did for me. They come along for me quite a bit where I have to say no to this, no to this, no to this. Another test today, actually. I'm just sticking with the new way as well. Practice, that's it. One insight does indeed settle it all. Don't need to repackage lies. Okay, that doesn't work. Repackaging. You know, repackaging our attempts to fixate the mind doesn't do anything. We can repackage forever. It won't do anything. So why bother with repackaging? Why pretend? Why pretend? Why even pretend? Why attend something that everybody hates you? Why even go there and let's go through this whole rigmarole of pretending you don't know? Just don't go there. Don't try to repackage false hope. Self-definition. Don't try to repackage self-definition. That's all we're doing. Lifetime after lifetime after lifetime. As long as we believe in self-definition, we'll keep having lifetimes. We'll keep transmuting through the flesh, through different appearances of the flesh, which is self-definition. That's all it is. So, why keep pretending I can repackage it some way when the mind can never be fixated? So it's all futile. Why keep doing it? So the new way practice here is for those who of us now and those in the future, those who will keep continuing to repackage self-definition, they'll continue to show up either in this world or some other place as a self-definition, a limited self of some, what we call flesh, the idea of a limited self, of self being defined, it actually appears as some sort of flesh, some sort of structure that we identify with. So this teaching is for all those in the future also who find themselves in such a hideous, fearful predicament, right? And so they know, oh, there is a way for me to practice devaluing self-definition by this practice, this full stop in the wow, new way practice where we block panic. And so we can devalue self-definition, realizing it shocks us, but at the same time, by just holding on to the wow structure, we say, I'll define myself as wow. And that's it, but nothing other than that. And this blocks panic. So this can get anyone out of the trouble of self-definition, and the trouble of self-definition can become, you know, hideously complex and seemingly impossible to resolve. But it's not. It's not impossible at all. Just none of it works. What's the difficulty of that? There's nothing to point out, except the mind can't be fixated at all. So it doesn't really matter how we package it. The attempts doesn't matter. One is no better than the other. No lie is more true than some other lie, right? So the one form of the impossible is just as impossible as some other form of it. You know, some label, it's all equally futile. So there's really nothing to judge about that. Lovely day here. We're getting very civilized weather. Perfect days. I wish they were a little drier. We get the marine layer mixing. Comes in the morning. It's heavy, heavy cloud cover. Gradually burns up, but there's still a lot of moisture in the air. So it feels a little warm. If it was drier, it would be even more beautiful. I was reading a comment. It's amazing how we tend to deteriorate here without hardly even noticing it. Our resolve tends to deteriorate. I went into a golf launch monitor. A while back, and I thought I had really worked on my golf swing and strengths for so much, and I thought I was going to have a super high swing speed. So I swing, and I was like 84. I was like, oh, this machine's broken. You know, kept swinging really hard. I think the highest I got was like 93 or something, just swinging out of my shoes. And I said, what? That's crazy. A lot of them were down in just, you know, the mid-80s, which is kind of a normal swing speed. And I was like, wow, I'm not as good as I thought I was. Isn't that amazing? So I realized I have to get better. So I really worked hard since that point. I don't know if I've gotten better or not. I haven't tested it out. I'm a little bit afraid to. It gives you a low reading. It's like, oh my gosh, I still have work to do. But we may not be as good as we think we are sometimes, right? We still have some work to do. So I really got after it since that time. Totally changed everything and just redoubled my efforts. And so it's faster now than it was for sure. So, you know, I don't know how much faster. But I'm thinking I'm maxing it out pretty good. Maybe I can coax, you know, a little more speed out of it. I believe I can if I keep working a little bit more. I'm trying to max it out, whatever that is. And it's fun to try that. So don't despair if you think, well. I mean, at the swing speed I had, I hit one like 275 on the launch monitor. I hit it just right at 275. Well, I'm swinging definitely a lot stronger now. So if I hit one good, it's going to go farther than 275. Well, that's good to know. But that, you know, who knows how accurate that was. But I think I was at, I hit a 250 was pretty much average if I really hit a really good 250. So maybe I was swinging like 90 miles an hour and hit it 250 or something. I said, that's just average. So I was just average. So, but I quit because I felt I was below average. I just wasn't hitting it good at all. I lost strength and everything. I don't know what the total gradual, we just declined. And so lost it all, and then just started, hey, let me see if I can get it back, and then I got back up to normal. You know, hitting at 250 is pretty good, actually. It's very good for my age, very good. But it's, you know, it's just a normal swing speed. And I said, okay, can we get it back even better to what, you know, when I was swinging younger? Can I swing that hard now? I believe I am swinging as well, better than I was when I was younger, actually. Better, because I'm working at it every single day and have been for a long time. And the you know, my muscles are in way better shape. I realize finally I have to really, you know, strengthen all the muscles and really work at it, and you know, use the protein that I never did that before. I was, you know, very low on protein, so I didn't build up any muscle mass. So I'm doing all of that stuff, and trying to, let's say, let's get even better than I was when I was young. Let's get even better. How about that? So, you know, it's not like, oh, I can't be 20 again. No. Maybe I can hit it better than when I was 20. Maybe I can do spiritual clarity better than when I was 20. Right? Why not? Working at it every day. When you're younger, you think, oh, it's easy. I don't have to work at it at all. Anytime, let's go to the range. Oh, sure, let's go. And you're so flexible and quick and stuff, you can hit it really well. You think, ah, easy. But you get older, it's not so easy like that. Have to work on all of that stuff. But in doing so, you may do it over and over and get really, really, really consistent, really good at it. Get the right equipment. Understand, you know, just a lot more attention to everything. You have to have a lot more attention to everything in order to do well. And as a bonus, you're not just winging it like when you're young. Same thing on the spiritual path. When you're young, you just think it's winging it. So I can do that. It's not so tough. I can do anything, right? When you're young, you say, I can do anything. I'm asking all these parents these days about their kids, you know, 20-somethings, and they say, oh, you know, just, oh, my God, you know, we can't tell them anything. They know everything. You know, we don't know anything. We're completely stupid. And they're just getting into trouble. They can't do this, that, but you know, they can do anything. And that's always the way it is, right, when you're young. So, you know, you tell someone about the spiritual path, and they go, oh, yeah, sure, I can do that, no problem. I can do anything. Yeah, what do I need to know? This? Okay, I got it. I'll work at it. Maybe I'll work at it a couple hours, and I should do it. And then they lose interest in it. So that won't get anyone anywhere, will it? So if you're fortunate and you make it a lifelong effort, ambition, to reach, you know, very significant goals, very significant goals. One insight settles it all. You want to get to that. You want to get to that. One insight settles it all. You want to get to that. In your lifetime, then you'll have to keep working at it more and more and more and more and more. You know, sweat some of the details. Sweat the practice. Do it. Can every day get better and better and better and better. There's no way around it. Because it's only that one insight that settles it all, because it's that simple. It's never complex. As soon as we try to bring structure into it, the insight, the recognition is gone. So you tell a young person, yeah, all you have to do is just give up any expectation of structure, and then you'll see the insight will arise, and you'll realize, oh, okay, I'm free now. I can see that and don't need to do that. Simple, right? And so the young people say, oh, yeah, okay, great. All you have to do is just give up all belief in self-definition and be comfortable. Expect that. So they try it, and like, whoops, what's that? I had a problem, huh? Felt kind of scary, dread. Like, what happened? Like an abyss. I mean, wow. I don't want to do that. It's scary, you know? And then they give up, right? But in my case, that happened. I said, hey, wait a minute. You know, that's odd. You know, what's causing that? I have to find out. This is not good. This is blocking me from reaching my, you know, real purpose here, which is just to be normal. And so I said, I got to deal with this, but easier said than done. So it's very humbling to keep every single day, keep coming up short for your whole life and not give up. Very humbling. But that's what happens. So humility is a great virtue. Humility doesn't mean that you just don't do anything, you don't try. Humility means you're trying at your utmost and you're still not succeeding. And don't give up. That's what really humility really means. It's funny, everybody's trying to pull us into drama. Everything around me is just unbelievable. You know, the people are just having all this incredible drama that is now suddenly happening. Relationships splitting up, you know, all those catastrophes in their lives. Just they're telling me, I just like, yeah, you know, okay. Yeah, new way practice, wow. The new way is wow. But these are all distractions, you see. Smokescreen. One insight settles it all. Just bank on that. You can't be a doubting Thomas. Show me the one insight. Well, you can't structure. You have to be willing to give up structure. So being a doubting Thomas doesn't really work. Okay, you have to have faith. One must have faith. And you catch glimpses of truth, and you know it's there. But you wonder, can I really get there? And why is it so difficult? Because our expectations are completely geared towards structure, self-definition. And so when we realize, oh, no self-definition is the answer, then we say, okay, but then suddenly, whoa, you know, I don't, what happened to all my expectations? What happened? I don't know what to expect. I don't know what to expect. And you go into shock, and then you try to figure it out, and you go into panic. And so we have to block the panic of this and keep doing that every day. Keep doing it every day. So I just keep working on every day, just like trying to get my golf swing faster or stronger, you know, more grooved. I just keep working on that every day, and it's fun. You just say, hey, I don't know how far can I go? I don't know. I just keep working on it, and so far so good. I'm pretty pleased with the results, and I feel. You know, very, very good, very nice, powerful. So yeah, that's great. But how far can I go? I don't know. I'll keep. I'm not going to put any lid on it. I'll just keep working on it. Same thing on the spiritual path. We just keep working on it. Don't put a lid on it. And when we're ready, these insights will come up. They'll bubble up, and I'll just say, "Oh, great, that's terrific." Yeah, but just say, "Wow, I have a structure for that." You say, "Okay, I got a structure for the peace of God. It's called wow." Just apply that. Wow. And that's it. You don't go any further than that. And then perhaps the peace of God will just kind of hang around. He says, oh, I can hang with that. I can hang with the wow. Not a problem. Let me just hang with the wow. Hanging out in a doctor's office today for 4 hours. It's interesting. I just said, I don't have any importance at all. I don't have any self-definition at all, so I can't get sick. I don't have any importance to get sick. I have to be important to get sick. I can't get sick. I can just be normal. Can't be sick. Can't be abnormal. So all these sick people, you know, just the parade of sick people is just like, wow. It's tough, you know, people look at you, what are you in here for? Me? Nothing. No, nothing. I can't get sick. I don't have the importance to get sick. You have to be important to get sick. I have no importance to me at all. No importance to any self-definition. So, yeah, I missed out all the fun. I mean, people get a tremendous sense of self-importance by hospitals and doctors and medicines. A medical rep came in, pharmaceutical rep. This woman, and holy cow, I was just sitting there in a chair, and she was talking to the nurses and the receptionist and you know, all her sales pitch and giving them everything. It was like unbelievable what I heard. I mean, that was an amazing 4 hours in the doctor's office. The stuff that I read about artificial intelligence and then the pharmaceutical rep coming in and how she operated, it was just extraordinary. It was just extraordinary. Wow, what a drug pusher she was. What a professional drug pusher. So confident in what she was doing. You know, like, you can't possibly say no to me. It's not possible. It's just frightening to go through that, hear that. I didn't structure my memory of it all, but I just, you know, registered the impression of it. Holy cow. That's how they do it. And you realize we're being railroaded into a black hole by this. you know, the doctors, and it's the nurses and the receptionist that she was talking to. She wasn't even talking to the doctor. They're too busy for that stuff. It's amazing. She goes, yeah, I got these samples here, this, now do you want this? This is what you recommend for this. And she's talking about price points and health plans, and yeah, if they have this health plan, we'll get them to this drug. If they have this one, we'll get them to that. And they say, if you need any samples, just call me anytime you call me. I'll just have them, don't worry, I'll just get them to you like that. You know, and it's like total drug pusher. And but easy, that the nurses, they just accepted everything she said. I mean, she had an answer, her spiel was just like, this is how it's done. There is no other way to do it, and this is what's going to happen. And that her attitude was just one of extreme confidence in what she was doing. Extreme confidence. And this is the attitude in this world. You don't expect it from women. You know, it's rather shocking. You would expect some sort of like wisdom about their children, saying, wait a minute, is this the kind of world I want for my children? But no, not a trace of that. Not a trace of that. It's very chilling, very cold. And there's an extra component there. It's like Nurse Ratched, you know. It was like Nurse Ratched saying, you know, here I'm the mother, and I'm passing out candy to my kids, except they're powerful pharmaceutical stuff of every type. Very chilling to hear that. And she was, you know, dressed up in this, you know, mini skirt, and kind of just the way she looked was just like this very glamorous woman, you know, very glamorous, super career glamorous woman. Like, I'm doing the world a favor. I'm here, and I'm, you know, I'm the answer. You know, I'm the answer. Here I am. I've got the answers. I've got the drugs for you. What more do you want? This beautiful goddess has got all the drugs for you. So she dressed up like a goddess figure and had this backpack full of drugs. It was just, here you go. Here's all the samples of this. This is how you do it. And she was just dictating to the medical people, this is how you do medicine. It wasn't the medical people saying, this is how we do medicine. It was the pharmaceutical rep dictating to the medical profession, saying, this is how you do medicine. You do it our way. And there was no doubt in her mind, she'd been trained so expertly, that this is how it goes. I talked to her. So I could go on and on about that, but you get the picture. So I experienced that. I just said, wow. Wow, 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 wow. And this goes on constantly in doctor's offices. They hit up every single doctor's office routinely, these reps. And these medicines are all going out to people. People are gobbling medicines. I don't even know what medicine is. I'm not important enough to know what medicine is. I really don't. It's something foreign to me. I really can't even relate to it at all. Can't relate to hospitals, doctor's offices, medicines, any of that stuff. It's just a vague notion, you know, to me. It's just a vague notion, some silly notion, some whimsical notion, really, is how it feels to me. But here she is peddling these whimsical notions as if they were like the most concrete, obvious thing that this is just how everything is done. And you don't have any choice about it, because I'm telling you this is the way it is. I got a lot of pushback in that medical office, you know, just trying to be normal in there. People said, what are you doing? You know, who are you? Kind of looking at me like, eh. I got a lot of hostility. You know, I just got up and walked around and I was just acting like a normal person. They said, you don't act that way here. You know, this is a drug dispensary, you know. I said, why? Feel out of place there. Out of place. I'm not important enough to be in a doctor's office. You know, what can I say? I'm an outsider to all that. Very much an outsider to the world, right? So, AI and drugs. I read another article by this, I think it was a famous basketball player, talking about opioid addiction. And he said it's up to like 62,000 or something people have died over the last year, overdose on opioids, mostly opioids. Oxycontin, Percocet, et cetera, et cetera. 62,000 people. And he's from the state of Kentucky. And he was pointing out that, like, they have like three or four deaths every single day from opioid overdoses in just in the state of Kentucky. Three or four deaths every single day of the year. And it's an epidemic. It's a horrible epidemic in Kentucky, West Virginia, various places. It's a catastrophe right now, actually, the opioid addiction. The United States has 4.5% of the population of the world, and we consume, I think, 98% of all opioids in the world. So, folks, the United States has a very severe opioid problem, not to mention all the illegal stuff that's going on, the heroin, etc. That should tell you something. Something's drastically wrong here. People are... Well, my Christian friend is—he told me he's taking an anxiety medication now. He couldn't handle it anymore. Has that got that bad for him? And he says, I don't really care about anything now. I just kind of nothing bothers me. I mean, a lot of people I know are on anti-anxiety pills. In fact, is there anyone that isn't? Is a question. I'm certainly not. And that takes away, you know, clarity of like what's wrong. So you can work on it. You just kind of feel, oh, nothing really kind of bothers me. I'm just kind of this sort of like this dreamy state. And yeah, that's the whole, it seems like the whole United States, we can afford all these medications, are on all these medications. Very, very, very bad. The opioids are just, and of course, even, you know, celebrities, Tiger Woods is, you know, in a rehab clinic right now for opioid painkiller addiction. He's one of the fortunate ones. Very few people get help from it, and very even fewer effective help. Most people can't kick the habit. And, you know, some of them can stay off it for a while. But it's a very, very dangerous thing, the opioids. And the pharmaceutical companies rig the data, basically, and the science around it to say that it's perfectly acceptable, no problem for prescribing it to people, you know, not in a hospital. And it's resulting in 60,000 plus people overdosing and dying every year just in the United States. Which is, you know, you put it in perspective, it's a calamitous, calamitous. And yet hardly anybody's saying anything about it. Pharmaceutical industry, right? Don't want to say anything about that. Wow. What a place. But it's okay. As Jesus says, focus on our own process of awakening, and by reshaping our expectations so that we will see, oh, one's insight does indeed settle it all. That's what I expect to happen. That's what I expect to happen. One insight will just simply settle it all for me. So expect that. This is a great, great contribution of Padmasambhava, our Dharma King Padmasambhava. And the great certainty of this in Tibetan Buddhism. The great certainty. So they aim you for it. They know this is true. So they say, hey, I absolutely can aim you and take you in the right direction and mentor you so that you will, it will all be settled for you, just like it has been for me. They say, absolutely. They're very confident about it, as they should be. So we love that confidence. We invite the confidence of the Tibetan Buddhists, the great ones. Super helpful, super helpful. One insight does indeed settle it all. And if we expect more than that, then we have trouble. Because we have that one insight and it's all settled. We say, okay, well, but what about the other stuff? Well, there is no other stuff. Well, it's got to be more complicated than that. No, it isn't. We simply were confused over the issue. Are we hallucinating because there's an absence of reality? We're trying to then, it was like, oh, reality had an absence and it's gone. So we need to have another reality quickly, or we'll be annihilated. So we hallucinated another reality, and we're trying to fixate the hallucination. Is that really the case, or was reality perfectly fine, and we wanted to try and change it, so we hallucinated the absence of reality? And giving up the absence, hallucinating the absence of reality, we'll just realize that nothing ever happened. There was never any absence of reality anywhere. So we don't need to try and fixate hallucination. See, which of the two is it, right? It's one or the other. So when we see very clearly it's one or the other, then we'll see which it is. It will just become self-evident which it is. And that's it. That's it. Nothing more to it than that. So as long as our expectations are that it's very complicated, there's a lot to it, then when we get the simple resolution, we'll say, okay, that's a great piece to it all, but what about all the other stuff? And then we'll say, I can't see the other stuff anymore. That's bad. I can't even see it to work on it. So you'll distract your attention away from the simple resolution so you can work on what you think is all the other stuff. But there isn't any other stuff. There isn't any other stuff. So you see how our expectations pull us away from the resolution of everything, all our regrets, gone, resolved. We never had to try and fixate anything. We never had to try and define ourselves. There was no reason to try and define ourselves at all, except our own desire to change reality, and reality is unchangeable, so no problem. There's really no problem at all. We don't have a problem, except our expectations prevent us from just resting in the simple insight that settles it all. We keep thinking there's something more to it. As soon as we believe there's something more to it, but once again, back in trying to fixate hallucination. Very simple, huh? So it's just this absolute simplicity of resolution that we're aiming towards, and we see, we expect complexity. This is the problem. We have to reshape our expectations towards this absolute simplicity. Nice simple drink here, strawberry lemonade. Tastes great. We will find that it's easier said than done to reshape our expectations. I mean, it is really, our expectations are so caught up in this notion of complexity, because we can't fixate hallucination. Instead of realizing that, we just insist that it's just really difficult and very complex. So we have this massive field of complexity and belief in how it's complex to hide the fact that there's nothing to it at all. We can't fixate hallucination. We don't need to, because it wasn't a matter, reality didn't cause us to hallucinate. There was no absence of reality that caused us to hallucinate as a protection from an absence at all. So there's really no trouble at all. We don't need to fixate it. But our long, long habits of expectation is that we will, but there's a lot to it, and we have to evolve our consciousness and over long periods, you know, and eventually we'll finally be able to stabilize hallucination. So you have to go against all of that. Very difficult. It's difficult in that you sort of have to go about it bit by bit by bit. Pragmatically. Theoretically, you can do it all at once, but pragmatically, bit by bit by bit, reshape your expectations towards more and more simplicity of resolution. The answer is like really simple. Keep telling yourself that. The answer is really, it's so simple. It's so simple. Believe it. It's so simple. And it is. It'll be like, you have the insight, say, oh, that's it. I don't need anything more. That's it. That's the sun. It's over. It's like, what? What about all the rest? No, it's over. And you're shocked by that. So we have to keep on saying, like, it's over. That's it. No more. I'm finished. Just like that, I'm done. I'm finished. Keep repeating this type of statement, like, I'm done. That's it. Just that simple. Simple. I see it, and that's all there is to it. There's nothing more to it than that. I'm done. For good. I'm done for good. I'm done for good. That's it. Amazing. Reading a story in the doctor's office about the swimming challenge in 25 or 27. From Catalina Island to the coast of Southern California, Wrigley, Mr. Wrigley, the chewing gum magnet. It was Wrigley Field, his name after him, the Cubs baseball field. And he sponsored this great race, and it was like supposed to be the greatest race in the world, and it was just a massive media event. And, only one swimmer actually completed the race. Only one swimmer completed the race, a young man. Amazing. Brutal, brutal race. The water is so cold. The currents are so treacherous. I mean, it's unbelievable. But the article touched upon the culture back then. And this is the culture my parents grew up in. And this culture got passed on down to us. And I was just reliving it. I said, oh my gosh, you know, it was the Horatio Alger culture of, like, you know, you can make anything out of yourself. Dream big. Think big, really big. You know, you can do anything. You can just practice, and you can swim in Catalina. You know, 30, it was more than swimming the English Channel. And people had this tremendous self-confidence and belief in themselves that physically, in this physical world, they can do anything. They can be this enormous success story. People were so optimistic. That's what caused, of course, the Great Depression. Just speculating and just, it's amazing. The kind of confidence they had back then. And I didn't know this, that Hollywood, I mean, LA was the boomingest town in the country, city. The movie industry employed more people than Ford and General Motors combined. It was the biggest industry in the country. This massive amount of people were working in the movie industry at that time. And people were just, you know, and also it was the first wave of feminism back then. It talked all about that. It was like the attitude, you know. It's like the women said, we don't want to wear swimsuits, we want to swim nude. And people, and you know, they said, well, why can't we do that, you know, and all this stuff. And it's like, what? So there's this really big feminist push back then. Women said, we can do anything at all. You know, that was the flapper era, the dancing. People were doing this marathon dancing and flagpole sitting. It was unbridled self-confidence and optimism. These people said, we can swim this channel, no problem. You know, well, guess what? Only one young man did it. Everybody else, Olympic champions, everybody was so confident in themselves. Man, they couldn't hack it at all. This kid lost 20 pounds doing it. It was just unbelievable what he did. And then he ended up losing all the money too. It was really quite something. But the aquatic culture back then was enormous. People were so into swimming, you know, and that got passed down to us. You know, all the swimming racquet clubs, the swimming pools, you know, just the swimming culture. I grew up in that swimming culture. We swam, we surfed, we swam in rivers and lakes and ocean, and people were still vibrantly confident, you know, in just so many things back then. Amazing. This sort of sunny optimism that anything was possible. If you just knew how to market and advertise it yourself right, anyone could be a star. You know, the star machine of Hollywood is, you do anything amazing, they'll make a movie out of it. My dad was the lead role in a movie, absolutely. He was signed by one of the major studios, Hal Roach Studios, I think, back then, and he was the lead man, a star in a movie. He lived in Southern California. So he lived that life of, like, anyone can get into movies. Anyone can be a star. Anyone can be famous. Anyone can be rich. Anyone can live this great life. We're all so vigorous and healthy and active and confident. We can never lose. It was like that. It was amazing. The naivete back then. Everybody was rushing to make their fortune. And that was in the 20s. Kind of like today, right? Everybody's rushing to make their fortune. But that I remember that the swim culture, wow, that was such a big thing. It was such a big sport, swimming. It's not quite as big now. It's not as big now as it used to be. But back, as we got into, you know, to the 60s, it was just huge, the swim culture. It was sort of a symbol of the vibrant, healthy life that you could lead. I don't know why, but it was. uh, So I was aware of a lot of the naivete that I was brought up with. It's like, how do you stand a chance coming into this world? You really don't, unless you have the help of the Dharma Kings. You really don't stand a chance. You come into cultures that are absolutely wacko, you know? Absolutely. And how can you come in and tell people the one insight sells it all, folks, and every regret you've ever had about self-definition vanishes forever, like it never was? And you don't have to keep on trying to define yourself at all. How do you go into any culture and deliver this message? Right? It seems impossible. I've managed to do it here, but it's been a completely unbelievable effort, really. I mean, there's just no way to even believe it, this effort. I don't know if I want to look back on my life at all. It's just been astonishing in how difficult it's all been. So this message just doesn't get delivered here enough. People are, the culture, you know, it's just, they're always on some, completely bizarro trip of, in one way or the other, in many directions. And it seems like we don't stand a chance here. Unless auspicious, you know, something auspicious occurs. Because again, the whole spiritual path is to accept the utter simplicity of the resolution. And we're hell-bent on burying that as much as possible in frantic efforts towards complexity of every variety. So we're always rushing into something that is, we think is really going to entangle us in massive complexity, giving, repackaging self-definition in endless ways. And thinking, this is the answer. We're really on track now. We're going to find the answer. And so how does anyone get born into this world and be able to deliver this message? It's just, you know, seems to be super rare, unfortunately. And it is. I keep looking for other, I keep finding spiritual people that seem that way, but it turns out their message is entirely dualistic. They don't get it at all, actually. They have all the trappings and the words and the concepts, ascended light, this, you know, all this, but dualistic, they don't know the remedy at all. And so you go into the world and people think, oh, you're really spiritual. Then they say, okay, you know, here, go study this stuff. These people really know what they're talking about. And you find out virtually nobody here knows what they're talking about. And then ultimately you finally find out there's a few that do. You know, the Dharma Kings do, the great gurus do. They know what they're talking about. But not hardly anybody else. Really. It's quite astonishing. It doesn't have to be that way. It's really the restlessness of our defensive-oriented culture to distract our minds. If you had a simpler Dharmic culture, then many, many of us could recognize this simple truth, work towards that. Because we'd settle down, we'd be patient. Yeah, we just spend our lifetime, you know, undoing all our bad habits of attention. And many more would start succeeding, and then that builds up confidence in a culture. But how do we build up confidence in any culture when no one's succeeding? No one's even trying, actually. Reading these magazines and just see, look at the culture, I just like, it's just, you know, virtually almost unbelievable, the level of distraction now in the world. Getting exponentially worse every day. You know, the rate of decline here is like a black hole. It's like falling into a black hole. It gets exponentially worse. Like, it seems like every day, every hour right now, like that. So, but we already have the answer, so it doesn't affect us really. Not substantially. If we have the patience, like we do here, to just keep minimizing that self-definition, devaluing it. I can never have a happy life. Self-definition can never be happy. So we just say, I can never have a happy life. I can never find any answers. Wow. I can never be at peace. Wow. I can really never do anything at all. Wow. Keep devaluing all self-definition except the wow. And we'll keep the wow because it's so beautifully abstract, right? And this enables us to do all the other practice without panicking, you see. Because we're still left with the wow. Even though I can never have a happy life, I still have the wow. And the wow is just wow. We don't define it any further. Is it happy? Wow. Is it not happy? Wow. So it's this very indefinite definition. You know, a fundamentally, completely indefinite definition, you might say. It doesn't say that we're happy. It doesn't, you know, I can never have a life at all. It doesn't say we can have a life. It doesn't say we can't have a life. It's just this, you know, very indefinite definition, you might say. So it allows for us to practice whatever, in whichever way we want to, without interfering or feeling conflict about it. So the miracles are still happening. So sometimes they just point out how atrocious the world is, and just say, "Oh my gosh, the drug reps, you know, like wow, they're so slick. It's so streamlined. They're just dictating." And the nurse is trying to raise objections. Say, "Well, what do I, you know?" And they say, "Oh no, okay, we got that. You know, this is how you do it. You know, if they don't like it, what if the patient doesn't like it? What okay?" They say. Okay, it's fine. If the patient doesn't want to take it, doesn't like it, then you can say, here's an alternative, and this is probably work for you better. What if they have a reaction to this? Okay, we have this alternative here. So they know what the objections are of the medical professionals, and they're trained, and they have very quick, smooth answers for all of it. And so they always tell you, well, you can just move them off of this onto this, like that. They never say, well, maybe they shouldn't, you know, take these medicines. It's not the answer for them. They always say, no, medicine is the answer, and we have the medicines for you. If they don't like this, you try this. So doctors are just drug pushers now. Our own doctor just told us this. She says, we're just drug pushers. She says she hates it. I said, what can I do? You know, everybody insists that I give them medicine. She says, you're going to have side effects. It's not good for you. I'll tell you that. Yeah. Doctors know it. They're just caught between a rock and a hard place. Doctors are compassionate people, but they're really, really stuck with the whole insurance thing and pharmaceutical companies. We know the answer is to reshape our expectations to greater and greater simplicity. We expect the answer to be totally simple, totally easy, totally obvious, and just one insight settles it all for sure. You don't need anything more than that. There's no variation needed. That's all structure. It's self-evident recognition. Oh, okay, so that's why we hallucinated. It wasn't caused by any absence of reality whatsoever. Yeah. Something like along those lines, right? It just becomes perfectly clear, and that's the end of it. Done. And then, of course, we worry about what people ask. Well, how did you do it? It was just one simple insight, self-evident insight, and that settled everything. People say, but I need more structure than that. No. We need to work, practice, reshaping our expectations towards that. Not to give a whole bunch of answers to satisfy the expectations of complexity. That's not the way. That's what doesn't work. Tom Carpenter asked Jesus, he said, Jesus, you know, isn't there a lot more information you can give out? And Jesus says, well, you know, I could give out volumes and volumes and volumes of information, but it would be much more profitable for you to just focus on this very simple, your own awakening, is the simple, 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 simple teachings I'm giving you, right? Really simple. That's way more profitable to you. And, you know, initially, if you feel like that, that's no good. We how can we be enlightened? Jesus is like incredibly complex. We have to have all this information. But, of course, that's what happens, that just keeps feeding our expectations, our false, erroneous expectations that it's complex, and we really don't get anywhere. We just get frustrated. So Jesus holds the line beautifully. You know, he's kind, but he's firm. He says, hey, no, it's just really, really simple. Very simple. And keep reshaping your expectations towards that acceptance, accepting that. It's that simple. That's the new way. Wow. The famous thing, there's only one way, Jesus, you know, they kind of, sort of, you know, twisted that a bit. But what they're saying is only one insight settles it all. That's what they're really, that's getting at, but they're not really aware of that. They think, no, it's only Jesus is the way, the person Jesus, sacrifice of Jesus, something like that. But it really means there's just one insight that settles it all. There's only one way, meaning just one insight. It's just one insight that settles it all. Not two insights, three, four, five, just one. You know, did we try to change reality, therefore hallucinate the absence of reality? Or did reality somehow fail and we needed to hallucinate a new reality in order to keep our identity? That's the question, isn't it? And when we recognize clearly what that the truth about it is, that's it. There's nothing more. Because then all the efforts to fixate the mind, to fixate hallucination, we realize is much about nothing. It's not needed at all. None of it. It was all totally unnecessary. Phew, gone. All regrets, just, you know, just okay. All regret. I don't need to stabilize hallucination. Hallelujah. And then all regrets gone as if they never existed. No trace. We're done. We're done, just like that. The modern world has no intention of ever getting anyone off of drugs. No intention whatsoever. My friend went to a psychologist, he's seen a psychologist. What did the psychologist ultimately do? Recommended going to a doctor and getting a prescription for these anti-anxiety. So that, you know, that's what you need to do. I thought he'd be like the last person in the world to do that, but I think he said in order to keep functioning, he had to do it. Wow. I know he's not happy about it, but it's kind of shocking. You see the people that you think are just stalwarts crumbling. Once you go down that road, it's tough to stop. Believe me, it's very tough to stop, because when you stop, the anxiety comes back, and you don't have the tools because you've been relying on the medication to deal with it, and you've gotten lazy in your spiritual path, really lazy. And then you panic and say, I don't know what to do. And then you go back on it. That's recidivism. Just like people come out of jail, of prison, they don't know how to function out in the world. They go right back in. They do something, so they go back in. They say, I can't handle it out here. I don't know how to function out here. Everything was taken care of for me in prison. I didn't have to do anything. I just eat and work out and, you know, watch television. Yeah. Recidivism. So, yep. But all of that trouble, the troubled mind vanishes, you know, when the one insight really does settle it all for us. Really does settle it all for us. And quite astonishing. It's over. That's it. Resolved just like that. So that's it. Done. Finished. Super simple. Totally simple. I'm done. Just practice that. Totally simple. I'm done. Wow. Totally simple, I'm done. Wow. Totally simple, I'm done. Wow. And you have to be patient right now. You see, people are struggling. So I had to be very nice today. Use my time to help those who are struggling really bad. And I couldn't really work much to earn money to pay bills because I was helping others who are really having a difficult time struggling. And they couldn't listen to what I was saying. They couldn't understand. You know, they can't focus well. It's like, wow, okay, you just have to be compassionate. Realize that means that their minds are in a whirl. You know, just like, oh my gosh, I'm going to have to use artificial intelligence. Will be the answer for me, you know, because it's so complex, only computers can figure it out. But I don't really want to go down that road. But here we have the message is that it's so utterly simple. We don't even have to think about it at all. Not one single calculation needs to be made. Not even one calculation needs to be made to settle it all. And our minds would be at absolute peace and bliss. And all regrets we've ever had utterly vanish. Just one simple insight that's self-evident. Don't need any trace of computation, computers, technology whatsoever to do that. Not a trace. Totally unnecessary. Doesn't help. They really don't help us at all. They give a false impression of some sort of complexity. Nothing to compute. There's nothing to compute whatsoever. Keep this in mind. There's absolutely nothing to compute. The smart houses that are coming for everyone, they're so smart, difficult, that people don't know how to do anything. I read this article today about in Seoul, Korea, which is really probably the most farthest along towards artificial intelligence any place in the world. They're into it just in a, they're all in on it, all in. And someone said, my house is so smart, I don't even know how to turn on the water. I couldn't figure out how to turn on the water. Because there was some app and some, you know, thing. It got so complicated. They said, I can't even turn on the water. Because I can't, there's nothing, there's no faucet to turn on. You have to do it with your, you know, your smartphone or press the right buttons or codes and stuff. Yeah? And their toilets are like so complicated, you know. there's like about 100 different options on their toilets. And everything is being run wireless by artificial intelligence in their home, in these homes, and is that what we want? You know, and that's just the beginning. I mean, it's just like they're saying, let's just put it everywhere for everything, and we'll all be perfect humans. It'll be wonderful. Yeah. Except it's so unbelievably complicated. I can't. You know, how many passwords does everybody have? I hate passwords. Some people have like hundreds of them. Everybody has to write down their passwords somewhere. But I remember people saying, I lost all my list of passwords. Oh, my life's over. You know, so terrible. It's horrible, horrible, horrible world that we have now. Getting more and more complex all the time. Face recognitions, voice recognitions, you know. Everything showing up. Who's coming? Okay, can they come in? They have to say something. This. Okay, what's the password? You know, life is just becoming this unbearable complexity of artificial intelligence. And everybody thinks this is the answer. You know, why do they think that? Well, because they think the answer is to stabilize hallucination, which means to distract the mind as much as possible through complexity, so we don't recognize the one insight. Like, hey, wait a minute, what really is this hallucination? Did it really arise as an attempt to save ourselves from an absence of reality? Is that really true or not? Is that a lie? Right? And so just looking at that, is it true or is it a lie? Just that single important fact. You see, we see it, and that's it. So what we're doing with this complex modern world is trying to find, you know, extreme distraction for ourselves. We're so scared, you know, to have it resolved. Extreme distraction. So they're making the world more and more and more complex. Say, this is good for you. But if you want to resolve this, it's not good for you. If you want to get to this one insight, then the modern world is not good at all. It's terrible. We need a reduced intensity of all this complexity. The golf course is wonderful. You get out there and it's just like, there's no gadgets hardly. Yeah, really. But I mean, you look out there, all you see is grass and trees and lakes. And there's just this little white ball. And that's it. You get up there, you hit the ball, goes through the air and rolls in the grass and ends up somewhere. And you could walk to it, you know, go to it and do it again. It's just like, you look around, you just don't. There's the pace is just the pace of nature. It's just, there's no pace at all, it seems like. Everything's quiet and still and not moving. And it's just like you take a break from the insanity of the world. You drive along slowly in a golf cart, and there's no traffic. How about that? No traffic. You're along this golf path, and there's nobody else there. The hole you're on, there's just you. And maybe your buddies. And there's no people around. There's no pharmaceutical reps around. There's just birds flying around. How many yards to hold? What is it, about 142 or something? Okay, all right. Hit it up there, see where it goes. I don't know, it's going kind of right over there. I'll go find it. Look at those beautiful flowers. Drive the golf cart up along the grass, just driving. I'm just driving on this carpet of beautiful grass, and there's flowers everywhere, waterfall over there. Nobody to bother me. Nobody to pester me. My phone, I turn my phone off. Lost your ball, drop another one. It's a little white ball, that's it. Have a drink of water. Chip the ball, it rolls. Hit it, putt it, it rolls. That's it. Very simple, very simple, very simple. So it's kind of going back to like a very, very simple kind of, almost, you know, kind of life. It's just like so simple. It's great, great practice. Sitting on the beach, just watching the waves, going golfing, just the simplicity of it is helping our mind, ease our mind towards ultimate simplicity, just that one insight settles it all. And there's nothing we need to say about it because we just tell others that's true. One insight settles it all. We don't have to give out volumes of information. Jesus started out with volumes of information and Journey Beyond Words, but he repeated it. It was very repetitive in terms of exhorting us. But we wanted it, like we thought, well, the answer's going to be really complex. So he gave us this huge amount, you know, 1,000 pages or something, you know, just so much. More than 1,000 pages. And we thought, great, this, you know, probably answers all our questions. But it didn't really answer all our questions at all. It just repeatedly pointed out, you know, how the misery that the ego had cast for us and how we need to go towards a simple remedy for it. And once we did that for a while, then he came out with even more simplified teachings, Journey Beyond Words, Other Voice, Dialogue on Awakenings. And ultimately he's come out with the New Way practice, which is just the New Way is, wow, super simple. Super simple, 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 okay? So he had to help us where we were, where at that point we thought that truth is just this incredibly complex metaphysical paradigm that you're going to spend your whole life getting all these parts and pieces to it and putting it all together, and it's just this, you know, super evolution of consciousness that is, you know, unbelievably complex. You need thousands of pages and many, many volumes and learn all these answers, and it's just like, you know, but it turns out to be just the opposite of that. We were totally mistaken about it. Totally mistaken. But we couldn't accept anything other than that. If Jesus just said, hey, the new way is wow. Right? That's it. I'm back. There's the teaching. The new way is wow. That's it. Nobody, no one could have accepted that back then. There, you know, not at all. We said, Jesus, I got 1,000,000 problems. I mean, you got to address each one of those problems. Come on. I need hope. Give me 1,000 pages of hope here. So he said, okay, I'll give you 1,000 pages of hope. And he did. Pretty amazing, huh? What a compassionate act that was, looking in hindsight. He just was able to beautifully stay beautiful and composed and loving and compassionate and helpful and all that, and just give us this massive walls of words and paragraphs and sentences, you know, and all this, pages after page, going over this and this and this and this and this, and from every angle kept going over it. But all the while, he was just kind of like a good shepherd herding us towards the safe, you know, haven, like a good shepherd herding the sheep towards a safe haven of utter simplicity. Total simplicity. One insight settles it all. And then that's done. It's finished. For good. Nothing more to solve, resolve at all. Nothing more to resolve at all. How about that? Nothing more to resolve at all. I don't hit heavy weights. I lift pretty, you know, light stuff, reps. 20 of this, 30 of this, 40 of this. And I don't get into the heavy stuff. I don't know. Will I someday? I don't have any. I don't have any plans for that. That can really sort of, I don't know, can mess up your body, you can strain yourself. I've heard people say that many reps of lighter weights is probably a smarter way to go. It's not going to build all the bulk, the real bulk that some are after, but it's really going to build in the kind of strength that's probably more functional. Besides, I'm working on the fast twitch fibers, making sure that, you know, that's what you want, to want to crack the whip on that Pro V1 and just send it out there somewhere in the vast field of beautiful field of emerald green. But really paint the sky with a trajectory. That's what you're really doing. You can't see the ball really fall. I can't see it fall. It's the trajectory. Just the ball, just boom. It's like, oh. You want to get that trajectory. There's a beautiful trajectory. The ball just whew, takes off like a rocket. Then it reaches sort of this peak, and then it just kind of levels off, and it just seems to fly. It's just like flying. It just seems like a plane. It's just like it has wings, and like a bird, it just keeps flying. It doesn't really come to earth. That's the backspin keeping aloft. And then gently, it gradually loses altitude to other, and comes to earth somewhere. But when you see a ball struck with a great trajectory, you don't forget that. You say, wow, I love that. I want to have that. That's amazing. It's amazing we can put that kind of trajectory on the ball. I used to enjoy, when I was younger, playing golf just for the spectacle of it. And hitting these great shots, these mammothly high shots. I didn't care about the score, really. I was more into what unique shots and memorable stuff. It just, let me see if I can do this. Let me try this. I'd try anything. And hit these just majestic, you know, blasts so far up in the sky, like they're never going to come down. That's fun. You know, I used to have so much fun. When you're trying to score, do everything by the book, it's, you don't have fun anymore. But I remember, wow, hitting a 12-degree loft and just, you know, with a whippy shaft and just crushing it. And the height that went, you know, wow, you just sit there, just marvel at it. Going up to like a rocket into the clouds, sort of lost up in these puffy clouds, and just, it's like, wow, the ball was just here, and the next second it's like flying up in the clouds. And you wish that you could be the ball, actually, and do that. Like we could just float. We could just go up in the sky and just float along like that. Wow. There's something, some recollection like that of just being, having no density at all. Just being able to float in the clouds without any effort. One insight settles it all. All our misgivings, fears, troubles, every manner of regret, just gone. Vanished in nowhere. Tracelessly vanished. Because all our fear is completely unfounded. No basis for any fear at all. No basis for any fear at all. So, all fear reactions, there never was any basis to any of them. Gone. There never was any basis for any of them. None of them. No basis whatsoever. That's the end of it, right? So start getting your confidence back here. You know? We don't care. AI has taken over. And that's the destiny of this planet now. It doesn't matter. You know, we have something that's you know, more powerful than AI, helps us outrun it. Absolutely, huh? We outrun it. No trouble at all. So regain your confidence. Regain your confidence. You can do it. Absolutely, you will do it. You will do it. Just keep working at it, as we do here. Very, very simple. Okay. Well, tomorrow's another day. And so we made the most of this one, right? So that's great. The new way is wow. Okay. Emphasizing just that one insight sells it all. Just one structure of reaction to this fact. Just one structure of reaction. Wow. And we keep on. The good shepherd keeps on herding all the, helping herd the sheep into this safety, right? Into the safe haven, into this safe haven from the wolves of complexity, all right? And fear, fear-based reactions and panic. So we keep this shepherding going. We keep it going here. We keep it going. Bring the lost sheep into that safe haven. Very great. The new way is wow.